Thank you. Well, I want to start by thank you the organizers also for having Hyperbaric, for having me here today. I want to talk about the high pressure processing as a technology for preservation of foods. This is a very interesting technology that was developed in the late 80s, but especially lately in this last 15 years has become like a global trend for preservation of juices especially, but also ready-to-eat meals, meat products, seafood products, and we will see more applications. Well, in Hyperbaric, I'm in charge of applications and sales, so that's why I will talk about the technology, but also some of the applications. And I will start by introducing the company, Hyperbaric. We were formerly NC Hyperbaric, and what we do is that we design, manufacture, and market industrial high-pressure processing equipment for the food industry since 1999. Now we are the market leaders with more than 160 HPP industrial machine installed in the 5 continents, and we have a market penetration of more than 70%. And how this technology works, how we apply pressure. We put the products in these baskets, and we place the basket inside the vessel, that is like a cannon made of stainless steel inside the machine. And what we do is that we close the vessel with 2 caps, and we pump water from a water tank, that is low pressure water. And when it's already full, then we close it completely with the caps, and we pump high pressure water through the caps. And that's why we are able to increase the pressure inside the chamber, inside the vessel. And once 2 or 3 minutes have passed, the time that we determine that is the best recipe for the product, we have the process batch. And why do we need this kind of new preservation technologies? It's because the trends in the consumer are changing, and the consumer now is demanding for food that is more convenient, environmentally free, friendly, fresher, more natural, healthier, safer. And what we need is also the industry to react and to design food that is less manipulated, with fewer resources, clean label, less processed, with less impact on nutrient, and pathogen-free. For sure, the safety is first. This is a little bit of history about HPP. As I told you, in the 80s were the first lab-scale application. In the 90s, we had the first commercial products available in Japan. That were some jellies with fresh fruits inside. And in 1999, Hyperbaric, our company, we started to develop these industrial machines, and was coincidentally was when the technology raised. The principle of the technology are the isostatic pressure and the Le Chatelier principle. Regarding the isostatic pressure, when we apply pressure to different parts of when the pressure is transmitted by water, we will have the same pressure in every point of the surface of the product. But also regarding the Le Chatelier principle, the system inside, well, the alive cells or the food or whatever we are applying pressure will react, trying to adapt to this changing environment, and we will try to react, and so we will generate some forces that we will try to compensate this pressure that is coming from the outside to the inside. And we will have pressure from the inside to the outside too, because we will have also water inside the food. When you compare this technology that is non-thermal with the pasteurization that is thermal, we have different aspects. So HPP is a non-thermal technology, it's a new technology, the pressure is instantly transmitted, but we compare with the pasteurization, we have a slow transmission and temperature gradients. If we have this complex, then if we are heating, we will have this the outside is hotter than the inside when we are applying heat. The pressure is the same in every point of the product, and we don't have any changes in the chemical composition of the food. And what is high pressure? When we are talking about the high pressure that we are reaching inside our machines, if this is the Mariana's Trench depth, that is almost 11 kilometers, we have to multiply by 6 to reach the pressure that we are having in the hyperbaric machines. Here we have another example. We are having 1,000 megapascal are two elephants in one coin of 1 square centimeter. So we are mostly in that range. And well, our machines can process at different times and pressures. And once we are increasing the pressure, we can have different applications. For example, when we stay at 3,000 bar, 300 megapascal, we have a very interesting application that is the mollus shucking and the crustacean meat extraction. We are not doing any sanitization of the food. We are not killing the bacteria. We are not killing, well, we are killing some of the bacteria, but the most part will be still alive. But we have a very interesting effect that we detach the meat of the lobster or the mussel or whatever from the shell. So it's very easy to open it, and we are saving money because we can reduce the labor, and we are also saving time. And from 4,000 bar, 400 megapascal, to 6,000 bar, that is the maximum pressure that we can apply in our machines, we have this kind of non-thermal pasteurization. We don't like to talk about pasteurization because we are not applying any heat, but well, this is how some of the people is knowing this technology, and we have to be familiar with it. And we can apply to juices, ready-to-eat meals, cooked products, cooked meat products, raw meat products, dairy products, guacamole and other vegetable products, foie gras and some other ready-to-eat meals, also fish. We will see it later. And what effect are we having inside? Inside the food, we have the low molecular weight compound, a big amount of water, the biopolymers, and microorganisms. We wouldn't like to have microorganisms, but they are still there. So all these components are affecting the sensory, nutritional, or microbiological quality of the food. And what happens with some of the components? That is the water. The water has some compressibility. We can compress it between 10 and 15%. And because of the compressibility of the water, we will have some adiabatic heat. And when we are starting, for example, if we start at 10 degrees, and we reach 400 megapascal, we are increasing like 8 degrees. So we can say that we are increasing 2 degrees by every 100 megapascals. Also, this is a reversible process. And we have also another thing, that is the electroctrition. This process is the water ionization. And we have some pH changes. We are reducing 0.3 by every 100 megapascal the pH of the product. This is also reversible and is due to because we are forcing the water molecule to be closer and we are making these kind of ions. And the low molecular weight compounds like the vitamins, simple sugars, amino acids, lipids, antioxidants, or volatile compounds are not affected at all because they have covalent bonds that are not affected by the pressure. The biopolymers in food that we are making some effects on them are the proteins and the carbohydrates. With the protein, we have an effect like this one. We have also been introduced by the previous speaker on this refolding that we can make on the proteins. And because the functionality of a protein is determined because of the 3D structure, if we change the 3D structure of the protein, then we can make an active protein or we can change the activity of a protein. For example, the protein determines the color of the meat, is like the myoglobin, that we can change with the pressure from the oxy to the deoxy state. That's why when we apply pressure to meat, we are progressively, when we are increasing the pressure, we have a paler meat. This is one of the most important problems that we have for the industry. We cannot apply high pressure to raw meats because of this discolorization effect. And a relevant type that are the enzymes. The enzymes are very very important because some of the enzymes are inanes because of the pressure. Some other are deactivate. Some other are activate or innate in different environments, different pH, different temperatures. So it's very complex. And that's why we always say that we must test every product, because we cannot say that if you have this enzyme, then you have this effect. No, we have to test every single product, because it's not only one enzyme. We have more enzymes, we have more components, so we have to test. The carbohydrates are responsible for the sensory quality, also for the nutritional quality. And regarding the sensory quality, with the pressure, we can also gelify some of the carbohydrates. So we have an impact on the sensory quality. For example, the gazpacho, that is a cold soup very common in Spain, especially in summer. When we apply high pressure, very high pressure, like 6,000 bar to the gazpacho, we have some gelation of the bread and some components of the tomato, some carbohydrates of the tomato, make some gelation that is like thicker. It's more like a salmorejo than compared to a gazpacho. It's an interesting thing. Well, still is good for some of the application, but if you are thinking that this is a gazpacho, it's not like a gazpacho anymore. And this is related to the starches, pectin, cellulose that can gelify. And of course, we will have some impact on microorganisms, because in the microorganisms we have proteins. For example, we have also impacts on nutritional properties. For example, we can increase the nutrients digestibility, because we can make some of the bonds weaker, so it's more edible, more digestible. Some sensory property, as I told you, we can change the color of the meat. And this is also a very interesting tool for new product development, because we can make, for example, some meat products like sausage with less salt, because we are preserving the food with a new technology, so we can reduce the preservative, we can reduce the salt. And we can also process the rice, and we can get an hypoallergenic rice. That is because we are also changing some of the starches of the rice, and it's hypoallergenic. And how we inactivate the bacteria? It's not like we are exploding the bacteria. It's that we are making some damages at molecular weight. As the previous speaker told, the membranes are sensitive to the pressure, so we can make some damages in the cell at the membrane and also at the inner cytoplasm of the bacteria. We will inactivate some of the housekeeping proteins. So if we are inactivating some of the protein, and very important, we are also deactivating some of the proteins that the bacteria needs to feed from the environment. So that's why we can kill the bacteria. And it's not that when we apply pressure, the bacteria has died. Is when we increase the pressure, we can make some damages to the cells that can be adapted during the shelf life of the product. But when we pass the barrier, the frontier of 4,000 bar, then the cells will have some irreversible damages and we will die. But the effect on different foods not only depends on the pressure, not only depends on the HPP, it depends also on the food itself, because some of the characteristics of the food are part of the food. We cannot change it. And it's also related to the pressure and the time that we can play with these variables and the target microbes. Because, for example, the more complex the organism is, the lower resistant to pressure. So, for example, us or some animals, we cannot survive even to 3, 4, 5 bar. Well, 5 bar is very exaggerated, but we can never reach 500 bar. The parasites, the yeast and molds are also very very sensitive to pressure. The parasites can tolerate to up to 2,000 bar. The yeast and molds up to 4,000 bar. And the bacteria, some of them can also resist to 6,000 bar. And the spores, this is a problem. We don't talk about HPP sterilization, because we will never be able to kill the bacterial spores, well, to destroy the bacterial spores, because actually are pressure resistant. This kind of structure are made by the bacteria to react to an environment that is increasing the pressure or that have very low resources. And the prions are also resistant to pressure. In the food, sorry, it's in Spanish. We have some of the variables that are that are also depending, the effect of the HPP is depending on these three parameters: the water activity, that is the available water inside, the pH. The pH makes like a synergy effect with the food. So when we increase the pressure and we have lower pH, we have a higher effect on the microorganisms. And some other characteristics like presence of antimicrobial compounds or compounds with baroprotective activity, like the calcium in milk. The calcium have like a baroprotective effect. So it's surrounding some of the molecules, and when we apply pressure, actually the real pressure inside is lower. So as I told, lower pH and higher water activity of water, because at the end the pressure inside the food is transmitted by the water. So when we have more water, more effective, that is the high pressure. So as I told you, every product must be tested, because it depends on a lot of parameters. And regarding the target microbes, the type of microbe, the initial load, the legislation of different countries, different continents is very different, and the target shelf life that we have, because if you want to have a shelf life of 15 days, then we don't need to reach 6,000 bar. We can apply 4,000 bar and you will have enough shelf life. As a conclusion regarding the HPP solution, HPP is a good answer to all these problems that we started, because it's a post-packaging process, so it's a less manipulated process. We can extend the shelf life when the food is already in the final packaging, so no risk of recontamination. We can reduce the cost from product failures and returns, because when we apply pressure to a packaging, that is vacuum packaging, MAP packaging, if there is a leak, if there is a small pore in the surface or in the surface of the product, then the water will be able to enter inside, so we can identify which of them are not having a good sealing or having a pore. We can reduce or eliminate the preservatives. This is the clean label concept. Don't know if you are very familiar with this concept, but it's the industry and also the manufacturers of food are trying to reduce the E components, the preservatives. So the target is that when we take a product from the supermarket, when you read the label, you have only the main ingredients. That is flour, eggs, whatever, milk. No E, no preservatives at all. It's a cold process, so we have a more natural product. We don't have any impact on the nutrients, and we can extract the pathogens, so we can have a brand protection. As I told you, we started in 1999, and from that date, the growth of this technology has been exponential, especially in America. But in Europe, we are not that bad. The global HPP food production in 2014, we don't have still the data from this year, it's more than 500 million of kilograms. And regarding the different applications that we are having, it's becoming lately very important for guacamole and some other vegetable products, but especially for fruit juices and smoothies. Traditionally, was very important for meat products, because we can have pathogen-free slide cooked meats like York ham or whatever, and especially when it's raw, like the Serrano ham and some other traditional products from Spain, from Italy, and so when they want to export to the States, to Canada, to Japan, to countries that are very restrictive in terms of the law, they ask for products that are listeria-free and salmonella-free. And this is the only option, the HPP, because we can process it in a cold environment and we are not affecting the quality of these raw products. Also for seafood and fish, it's very important for oyster shucking, lobster shucking, clams and mussels. We will see a video later, so you can see the effect of the pressure in this food. And the toll processing is also becoming very important. With toll processing, we mean companies that they are not producing any food. They are just buying the machine and they are doing services for other companies. So the other companies that want to access to this technology, they pay per cycle, per kilogram, per whatever, on a contract basis. So they can access, the small companies also can access to this technology, so it's very, very important. The value propositions are, of course, the natural appeal, the clean label concept that I told you. We can reduce the cost from product failures and returns, and also exploit capacity. Because the machine is, the production is in line, so we can adapt the machine to the production line that is already existing in the company, and we don't need to make any major changes. Of course, the food safety is very important to destroy the pathogens and protect the brand. And as I told you, to export to very demanding countries like the States and Japan. And it's a very important tool for new product development because we can make very different products like what I told you, this hypoallergenic rice, or we can make gelation on some foods that usually were liquid. So we can have very interesting propositions. And focusing on applications, I want to show you some products that are already in the market, just to see the packaging, so you can see some of the brands that you are used to see in the market. In meat products, the main purpose of this of the usage of this technology is the shelf life increase and the destruction of the pathogens like Salmonella, coliforms, Listeria, and reduce the preservatives or the salt inside. If we can see here, the total aerobic microflora, this is storing days, so we can have 60 storing days, and you can see that the microflora is the aerobic microflora is still under the safe limit. It's the same for the coliforms and for the lactic acid bacteria. It's suitable for vacuum packed or MAP. And we don't have any size volume effect because we can also process a whole Iberico ham. If it's packaged in a vacuum packaging, because we will have the same pressure in every part of the product. When it's a that dry product, like an Iberico ham, that is very, very dry, especially in the outside and so, but we have to increase, we have to process at 6,000 bar, and we have to increase the processing time like to 8-10 minutes, because the pressure is not that effective like when we have a lot of water inside, but it will still be effective. If we compare here the known process profile with the HPP profile, you can see that in color, juicy, tenderness, elasticity is mostly the same for this kind of cooked ham. In terms of safety, this is our different serotypes of Listeria, and even for the most resistant, we can processing 5 minutes, we can reduce 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 logs. Espuña in Spain were the pioneers in having these meat products in the market in the world, HPP products in the world, and they are applying this process to the cooked ham, but also to dry ham. They have this kind of ready-to-eat meals too, that are called tapas, and are ready-to-eat that you can place in the microwave for 2 minutes, and is cooked because the topper layer detached from the lower one, and with the steam that is generated inside in between these two layers, the product is cooked, and you won't have any loss of water or whatever, so the quality is not affected. Campo Frío is also very known in Spain. In 1998-99, they were very concerned about the Listeria contamination in the States of the Sara Lee products. And in April of 2002, they buy one of the first equipment that we installed in the industry, that was a 300 liters machine, in order to be able to export to the States and Japan this kind of cure products. Also, they developed this kind of vuelta y vuelta products and so that were ready to eat. And the problem is that when you are slicing the product when it's already cooked, then you have the risk of contamination with listeria, and that is where is the risk. So when we apply another process when it's already in the final packaging, you are reducing, well, you are eliminating that contamination. More examples. In Canada, this is in the States. I want you to see mostly the packaging that they are having. So you can see vacuum packaging, MAP. And this is very interesting because this is raw. This is like a pâté. It's called filet américain. It's like a steak tartare or something like. It's seasoned meat. Mine's very, very small. And it's raw. And in here, the problem of the color is not because they are adding some paprika and some other ingredients that are stabilizing the color. MRM, they are here in Madrid, in Móstoles. We are trying some of these dishes after in the food show. We have sausages, even organic pet food. With less preservative, because now we are caring a lot even for our pets. We want to take care of the pets the more possible. So this is from the States. In Europe, we don't have still this kind of propositions, but we will have it in the future. And for seafood, mostly for sucking oysters and ready-to-eat meals, and also for lobster. You can see that we can detach all the meat from the crust, and the product is still raw. That is very interesting, because then you can send it to the restaurants or whatever, and they will cook it to the exact cooking point that the cook wants. Because the alternative to this is first cooking the lobster, then you remove the meat, and then you have to cook it again, or at least heating it again. I want to show you a video. Well, you can see this technology to open clams. No packaging in this case, because the shell is the packaging itself. And you can see that are already open. Of this machine, 55 liters. This video is very funny. So they can reduce the labor. At the beginning of the video, I put it in the place where they were about to process it. You can compare, because they are doing it by hand. So you can see like five or six people opening the clams, and now just one is enough. And we will see the lobster. Actually, when you cook it, they are suffering more than in here.
Is lobsters outside also? Lobsters outside for the food shop?
No. Not today. I'm sorry. So you will see how easy it is to remove. So in here you have 100% of yield of extraction of the meat. You are not losing anything. Even the meat from the anthems. They are very expressive. I think he says that is delicious. Okay. Sorry, I have to come back to the presentation. We have different examples from all over the world. Ocean Choice, that is in Canada. We have a company in Barcelona that is doing the same product. This is the company that we have seen in the video. If you are receiving the presentation, you can go to with the, this link to the YouTube video. And this is the packaging that they are having for the clams. Another company in France. And this is also very interesting to extend the shelf life of fresh fish. Not very commercial products at the moment, but developing. And regarding vegetable products, the most important is the guacamole, because with the HPP, we can reduce or even inactivate the polyphenol oxidase, that is the enzyme that is responsible for the browning of this product. So we are extending the shelf life, but also stabilizing the color of these products, and also some salsas, dips. Some of the packagings are like this kind of cups or this kind of soups. This is from the States, but we are having some brands also here in Carrefour that is called Mama Cuchara, and some other companies that are producing also wet salads made of pasta with some other ingredients, rice, lentil, beans. And later we will also try this kind of juices from Abomix that are also made in here in Spain. And also we will try the guacamole. And when we go to the juice and smoothies, I told you that is the most important application lately. And it's because of the shelf life of a fruit juice is like 3 days, 5 days maximum if the pH is very low. But with this technology, we are having juices that are very natural and that are lasting 3 months up to 6 months for some brands. We are preserving also the color, flavor, and vitamins. And of course, we are extracting the pathogens and the microorganisms. For example, regarding antioxidants, in an apple juice, we are having the 100% of the initial antioxidant power. In an orange juice, compared to the control, we are losing, let's say, 10%. And I'm being very pessimist. Apple juice. The same, almost the antioxidants are intact. Well, for a different antioxidant, sorry. And it's the same for the orange juice. When we talk to folic acid, vitamin C, niacin, vitamins in milk, so when we compare the control and with the HPP1, and here we are increasing progressively the pressure, we have almost the same figures. At the end of the shelf life, an HPP juice can retain 85% of the initial vitamin C compared to the thermal process that they are retaining also 40. And also some examples that you can see in the market. This is a product from Australia, but eventually you can have it in El Corte Inglés. It's a very nice product because they invested in this kind of very innovative packaging. When you see it, you think more of a pharmaceutical product rather than a fruit juice. And they have another interesting thing is that you can find the special variety of apple that you like the most. So you can have juice that is made of Granny Smith apple, Pink Lady apple, whatever. They were also very innovative in the logo. They wanted to transmit that they are fresh and it's a cold process. They are applying pressure. So when you combine all of these things, you have the Presafruit logo. So the marketing, because they were the first ones, so they needed to invest a lot in marketing and so, because it wasn't that easy when everyone was used to open the typical Tetra Pak juice to make them to change to a high quality juice like this. Another company is from the UK, is called Colpress. You can find this also at El Corte Inglés. They have plenty of awards because of the quality. It's more or less the same concept that the previous. It's different apples. They mix with some other fruits, but mainly apple. This company is from Spain. You can also find in a lot of supermarkets. And what has become especially important lately is not only to have fruit juices, but also fruit and vegetable juices, what are bioactive juices that are having all the green compounds that you need for every day, with plenty of antioxidants and so, because lately we are not having a very healthy diet, even in a Mediterranean country like in Spain. We are going to the ready-to-eat meals, we are abusing of meat products, we are not having all the fruits and all the vegetables that we should every day. So this kind of proposition is becoming very popular in the States, in Australia, and this is also happening in Europe. Companies like Suya that have recently been purchased by Coca-Cola. The 70% of the business of Coca-Cola is the carbonated drinks. But since they are noticing that the consumer is changing and that we are reducing the content of sugar of our diet, and they are losing in this kind of business, they are investing in some others, and one of them is this kind of company. Blueprint, they started this cleanse trend. The cleansing is that you don't need any solids during the day, you just drink these six juices. So they design every recipe for different times of the day. So in the morning you have more carbohydrates compared to the one that you should drink at night. And this is a concept like a liquid diet to detox, to erase all the bad components from the body. Another example, this one is from Spain. You can buy it online, you have the link here. And another drink that is become very, very important is the coconut water, because it's a natural isotonic drink with a low sugar content, lot of mineral salts. We have here different brands. This also from Spain, you can find it at El Corte Inglés too. And for dairy products, I said El Corte Inglés because El Corte Inglés is usually the most gourmet supermarket, so you can find some products that you cannot find in others, but El Corte Inglés is not paying me at all. And regarding the dairy products, also the purpose is to increase the shelf life, distract the pathogens, and preserve the emulsion that sometimes with the temperature is not that active, this emulsion, and with the HPP we make it more stable. And also retaining the bioactivity of functional components. This is regarding a very special product that is made of eggs, that is fertilized eggs. And it's supposed, and I say it's supposed because there is a lot of marketing behind this kind of product. This is made to reduce the inflammation, and it's supposed to be good for to make it better processes like cancer or some other diseases. But this is a very sensitive thing that, and because of that, I say that it's supposed. When we say interesting products, this is colostrum beverage. And in the colostrum, we have plenty of immunoglobulin G and growth factors. So when we compare the unprocessed with the HPP1, we are retaining the 90% of the immunoglobulin G. And when we have a heat treatment, we have less than 5. This is a product very interesting, made in New Zealand and mostly sold in Japan. Because in Japan, they care a lot about the health, they care a lot about the diet. So that's why that is the niche market for this kind of products. HPP milk. It's not that easy to have an HPP milk because the growth of the microbes in the milk is very, very fast. So we need to process the milk just in the next hour, maximum 6 hours after milking. Some yogurts with some fruits inside, snacks made of cheese. And a very nice application is these rodilla sandwiches that are the filling of the sandwiches is made of cream cheese or mayonnaise based always. And they have a factory here in Madrid, in Carabanchel. They used to do all the recipes every day, and they needed to wash everything when they change it from, for example, a tuna recipe. Then they needed to clean everything because of the allergens. And so with this technology, they are processing. They are not doing the fresh sandwiches every day. They are doing the fillings, and they are processing these bags, these big bags of the filling, so they can preserve the quality for 1 month. And is these bags the thing that they send to the restaurant? So they are doing the sandwiches at the restaurant, and they are reducing a lot the waste. And in terms of factory utilization, is very simple, because now, for example, Monday and Tuesday, they do only one kind of filling. Well, of course, they have to clean every day, but they don't have to clean between every 2 hours or 3 hours like they usually in the past when they change it, the recipe. It's also very interesting, this kind of dressings for salads and the fresh cheese. It's not that surprising that Hyperbaric was born in Burgos, and in Burgos we have plenty of fresh cheese companies, so that's why I cannot show, well, in this case I'm showing the brand, but I cannot show the brands of the most part of that, but in Burgos we have plenty of industry making fresh cheeses, and almost all the brands that you can find in the market are applying HPP to the cheeses. And regarding the toll processors that I also told you, we have Millard in the States or APA Processing in Spain. You can visit the website. These kind of companies are giving access to small companies to this technology, just paying per cycle, per kilogram. And as a conclusion, the benefit of this high pressure processing technology is that it's a non-thermal pasteurization, it's an unique tool for deselling and extracting the raw meat from mollusks. Safe process with a positive image in the public, because at the end this is very natural. This is like putting a product in the deep ocean, so we are not having a very strange effect on the food. We have very easy installation, and the ready-to-eat HPP products are very successful because they are getting longer shelf life with no chemical additives, no reduced content of salts. You can put natural claims like minimally processed, never heat pasteurized, preservative free, whatever, and with high sensorial qualities. You are very welcome. You can visit our website or contact us through the different ways. We have the office that is in Burgos, but we also have an office in Florida, in Miami, and another one in Oceania. So feel free to contact us. And your turn now for the questions.
Do you have any questions, David?
Okay, Stefan. What's the typical cost of one of your machines? Let's see the standard.
Well, the smallest one, that is the 55 liters that we show in the video, is more than 500. Well, let's say 500,000, half a million euro.
So, but I guess the delivery costs are quite high because it's heavy equipment.
No? Well, actually, in the European Union, that we have a lot of facilities because we don't have borders in terms of commerce and so. And when we are exporting to the States, sometimes it's very heavy. But in the States, it's not that bad. It's worse in countries like Brazil or so, where they have to pay like 20% more for the machine because of the taxes.
How can you identify that harm comes from after high-pressure processing?
Well, I'm talking about El Corte Inglés again, but the Hypercore brand at El Corte Inglés, you can see in the carton box that they, well, it's a vacuum packaging with some carton on the top, and you can see product processed by HPP. So you can see some of them, they are saying in the packaging that they are applying HPP. Some others, they are not saying anything because they want to have an advantage against the competitors. And they don't want to say the competitors why the product is lasting longer.
Okay. Jordi.
Well, I have there used to be a problem in Europe by the number of food regulation. In Spain, the situation tends to be a little bit more flexible. Well, what's the situation now? It seems to be not compulsory to agrar.
It's still not mandatory in Spain. Now, as the novel food regulation is so complex and anyone is understanding anything, at least regarding the HPP, because this is our feeling, because the customers contact us regarding this kind of thing. We try to mediate with the authorities of different countries. And what is happening is that in every country they are developing their own regulation against regarding HPP. In the UK, they are elaborating now a list of different companies, of all the companies that are applying HPP. In France, they have a special regulation for HPP uses. This is also happening for ready-to-eat meals, especially made of fish in France. So in every country, they are acting differently now. But it's supposed to be regulated under the novel food regulation, so we will see in 2 or 3 years when they finish and when it's perfectly clear all the basis for this for all the manufacturers in all the countries.
What is your largest volume that you contemplate?
Yeah, the biggest machine that we can offer have a vessel of 525 liters. 6,000 bar.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.